We shall start today's class. As usual, before starting today's class, let us have a quick recap of last class topics. In the last class, we started with something called as capacitor filter. And this capacitor filter, the intention to use this capacitor filter is to improve the output of rectification by reducing the ripples, that is the amount of AC content which is very highly predominant in the output of half wave rectifier or full wave rectifier. We are aiming to reduce that content by using something called as a capacitor filter. A capacitor filter is very simple circuit. It consists of a single capacitor which is connected across the output load or across the load resistor, which is as shown in this figure 13A. This is actually having a single diode, therefore this is half wave rectifier with capacitor filter. This circuit is also called as peak rectifier. It is also called as peak rectifier, and the operation is very simple. The operation of this is based on charging and discharging of this capacitor. We know that the capacitor takes a finite amount of time to charge from 0 volt to the maximum applied input voltage, and it also takes a finite time to discharge from maximum input voltage to zero. And we know that operation of this capacitor filter mainly depends on charging and discharging concept of this capacitor, and usually it is aimed to have a capacitor of maximum capacitance value which has a maximum charging and discharging time. So how does this work is whenever the voltage across this capacitor is less compared with the voltage of applied input to this rectifier, then capacitor will start charging and diode will conduct. As soon as the voltage across capacitor becomes equal to the applied input voltage, then conduction of diode stops and capacitor starts discharging in the reverse direction. Therefore, the current from capacitor will flow through the load resistance RL. The time for which the diode remains on is very short time, that is denoted by delta T. Delta T is T2 minus T1 only for this short duration, that is nearly equal to or closer to this peak of positive half cycle only this diode would conduct. And for the remaining duration, the capacitor will be discharging and it would be acting like a source and it will send the current through this RL. Therefore, we have the output response something like this, where if we measure the peak to peak voltage or peak to peak ripple voltage, it is found that the amount of ripple is very much less as compared with the output of half wave rectifier without capacitor filter. And here, this is the formula for ripple factor, which is 1 by 2 root 3 fc into rl. Now we shall and after that we have discussed the full wave rectifier with the capacitor filter. In this the operation is almost same, but the difference is we have two diodes, and any one of these diodes will conduct during one of the half cycles. During positive half cycle D1 will conduct. During negative half cycle, D2 would conduct. And whenever the diodes are conducting, there would be charging of this capacitor. And once this capacitor is completely charged, the diode would conduct only for a small amount of time. Only when the voltage across this capacitor is less compared with the applied input voltage or secondary voltage, the capacitor would charge and diodes either D1 or D2 would conduct. D1 would conduct for a short duration during positive half cycle, and D2 would conduct for a short duration in the negative half cycle. That's why you get the output like this. The small red lines indicate that the diodes are conducting for a short duration. This is with respect to the first half cycle where D1 would conduct. Later on, after reaching the peak, the capacitor would discharge and D1 will be off, right? So during second half cycle, you can see D2 is conducting for short duration, and after the voltage across capacitor reaches peak, then D2 would become off and capacitor would discharge and so on. Here we find that the ripple voltage is VDC divided by 2FCRL, and ripple factor here is given, here the ripple factor is given by this formula, 1 by 4 times root 3 FCRL. After capacitor filter, we have discussed photodiode in the previous class. Photodiode is also a PN junction diode, which usually works in a reverse bias condition. It works in reverse bias condition, and upon fall of light, means whenever the light is incident on this, it will carry a high current. When it carries a low reverse saturation current, when no light falls on this, that current is called as a dark current, and you can see the magnitude of that dark current in this VI characteristics. It will be very small. When the light falls on this photodiode, depending on the intensity of light, if the intensity is around 1000 lumens, then current would be slightly higher than the dark current. If you increase the intensity to 2000, again the current would increase, and so on. The current in this reverse biased PN junction diode depends on the light intensity. Higher the light intensity, higher will be the magnitude of current, and that is how this photodiode will work. And the most important application of this photodiode, what we are using in our daily life right now during this situation, that is the pulse oximeter. Then afterwards, we have studied LED, which is light emitting diode. LED is usually operated in forward biased condition. It is also a PN junction diode, which is operated in forward biased condition. So here you can see one difference compared to photodiode. The arrow marks are directed outwards, means this diode would emit light. Whenever it is forward biased, it would emit light. And this works on an important phenomenon called as electroluminescence. This electroluminescence is related with the recombinations of electrons and holes during forward biased condition. Whenever recombination of electrons and holes takes place in certain materials like gallium arsenide or gallium phosphide, what would happen is a sufficient number of photons would be generated, and remaining part will be liberated as heat or power dissipation. So a large amount of current would flow, and the arrangements of this or construction of this diode would be such that one of the metallic contact will be completely closing one surface, and the other metallic contact at the P region, it will be a short one, so that there would be a gap between two metallic contacts for the light to be emitted outside. And this is how this would work. And some significant colors which this LED would emit is red, green, orange, or blue. Other colors are also possible. After LED, we have studied one important device called as photocoupler. This photocoupler is actually a package or combination of LED and photodiode. So we have an LED which emits light, and we have photodiode which works on which depends on the light which is incident, which receives the light and allows a high amount of reverse saturation current to flow. And the important application of this or significance of this is due to the electrical isolation which this provides. As this provides electrical isolation, we can use this to couple or join the circuits which work on different voltage levels, which may work on several thousand volts. Such type of circuits we can combine because of this electrical isolation property of this photocoupler. And the voltage output from this photocoupler usually will be measured across this R2. This R2 can be a load resistor, or in place of R2, you can connect one more circuit which will work as load for this photocoupler. The significance of this battery or source is to put this photodiode into reverse bias condition initially. Similarly, the work of this voltage source is to put this diode in the reverse biased, in the forward biased condition, LED in the forward biased condition. Next, we have studied some of the applications of photodiode, LED and photocoupler. Some of the important applications or areas in which these photodiodes are used is a camera, medical instruments like a pulse oximeter, safety equipment like smoke detectors, flame detectors, automotive industry, and in normal industries where we use barcode scanners, in all types of industries, encoders, etc. LED, the main application is TV backlighting. This is used in most of TVs nowadays. It will be used for backlighting of your screen. And apart from that, it is used for indication purpose in almost all daily life equipments, and it is also used for decorative purposes. Then photocoupler. Photocoupler has some peculiar applications. It is used in a microprocessor. Then microprocessor is like a small computer, or it is a basically a chip which can be used for different computing purposes. Even your PC or laptop and mobile also has a particular microprocessor. Then photocoupler can also be used for DC and AC power controller, signal isolation, and PC communications. In this class, we shall start with 78XX series topic. So before going to this 78XX series, we shall go back to the topic of voltage regulator using Zener diode, because this 78XX series is also a voltage regulator, and this is an IC voltage regulator. The physical form of this 78XX series devices would be an IC, and it is having three terminals for performing voltage regulation. And in place of XX, we have to substitute either 05, 06, 08, 10, and so on up to 24. So we have these different devices in this series. For example, if XX value is 5, which means that we have an IC whose name is 7805, and this IC would produce an output of 5 volt. Similarly, if we have an IC 7806, 7806 would produce 6 volt, and so on. And 7808 would produce 8 volt. Similarly, 7824 would produce 24 volt. That is how this XX works. This actually indicates the last two digits of this name. And the last two digits, you can place any one of these values. And depending on this, we have different devices under this series. So first, we shall revisit our voltage regulator using the Zener diode. So what is meant by, this is the topic, Zener diode as a voltage regulator. What do you mean by a voltage regulator? So voltage regulator is a device or a circuit which produces constant output voltage despite of change in its input or any change or variation in the load current. That is what is a voltage regulator, right? So it is a device which is used to produce constant voltage, right? While producing constant voltage, it can withstand any variation in its input, that is input supply, or any variation at its output, that is any variation in its load resistance or load current. That is what is a voltage regulator. Here we have discussed a simple Zener diode which works like a voltage regulator. This is simplest form of a voltage regulator, the Zener diode. And in this voltage regulator, we have two techniques or two conditions. One is line regulation. Line regulation is a condition where you have variation in the input supply, that's all. And the load current would be constant in case of line regulation. Load current and other resistances would be constant in line regulation. In case of load regulation, we have variation at the output. Means output load or output current would vary, provided the input voltage would be constant. So these two techniques, that is line regulation and load regulation, are common for all kinds of voltage regulators. Now we shall study these things with respect to 78XX series devices. So you should be knowing the general definition of a voltage regulator. Then afterwards, you should be knowing the two conditions that exist in a voltage regulator, that is line regulation and load regulation. Here in figure 18, you can see a simple functional block diagram of this 78XX series devices, which is a three terminal regulator. So here you can see the three terminals, right? So the one is Vin, second one is Vout. Then we have a common terminal, which is usually connected to ground. And here we have two blocks. One is pass transistor. Second one is thermal shutdown and current limiting. This pass transistor block is basically a single transistor. It can be BJT or MOSFET. So the work of this pass transistor is the work of a switch. Depending on the input of this thermal shutdown and current limiting block, this pass transistor would allow or not allow the input voltage Vin to appear at the output. Here we have a block which is called as thermal shutdown and current limiting. So this will do two works. The first work is if the temperature or the heat dissipated inside the IC is beyond the limit. The limit could be around 175 degrees centigrade. If the temperature is more than that, then this thermal shutdown would insist this pass transistor to turn off. Whenever this pass transistor turns off, the complete IC is shut down and you will not get any voltage at the output terminal of the IC, which is Vout. And it will do one more thing, that is current limiting. Whenever the excess load current flows or excess input current flows, so what this current limiting part of this block will do is, it will insist the pass transistor to limit the current. This pass transistor will act like the controlling switch. By partially turning on or turning off this pass transistor, you can control the load current also. These are the two tasks that are performed by this block. Apart from that, we have an amplifier, right? So this triangle block box with the minus and plus is basically an op amp which is working like a comparator. So one end of this op amp is called as this positive sign is called as non-inverting input terminal. This is connected with V reference. V reference is a reference voltage based on which the comparator will perform comparison. The second inverting, the second terminal of this op amp, which is indicated by minus sign, this is called as inverting input terminal. It is connected to the voltage divider. So this is a voltage divider which is combination of R-2 and R-1. At the one end of this R-2, we have the output Vout. A part of this Vout would be fed to this op amp through this connection, right? And whenever the voltage at this node is not equal to the voltage V reference, then this op amp would indicate this thermal shutdown and current limiting part to do some corrections in the pass transistor. So simultaneously, this pass transistor would either increase or decrease the voltage which is flowing at the output terminal, thereby controlling the output voltage or maintaining the output voltage, right? So this op amp, which is working like a comparator, so as it compares these two voltages, most of the times the both voltages would be at the same value, that is V reference, right? Because if both terminals are not at V reference, this pass transistor would make adjustment such that again you will get the value at this node as V reference. Therefore, usually both the terminals would be at the same V reference value. How to calculate output voltage is, the output voltage is given by this formula, which is given by the supplier of this IC or manufacturer of this IC. The formula is R-1 plus R-2 divided by R-1 into V reference. This is the formula using which you can calculate V out. Or else in other sense, from this formula, if you want a particular value of Vout, for example 5 volt, you can calculate what is the amount of V reference that you have to apply, right? So you can just cross multiply this ratio to the LHS side, and you can find out what is V reference. That is how we can calculate V reference and apply a specific value of V reference to the non-inverting input terminal of this op amp. Then afterwards, coming to R-1 and R-2, these two are internal resistances. They are not connected externally. The complete thing is present inside IC. R-1, R-2, both are present inside IC. And the value of R-1 and R-2, these two resistances are set by the manufacturer itself, right? And this reference voltage is just like the Zener voltage or a Zener reverse breakdown voltage. Based on this reference voltage only, you can get the output value as a constant one. And coming to tolerance, tolerance is around plus or minus 4%. So if the output voltage expected or nominal output voltage is 5 volt, you can expect this voltage to be in a range of 4.8 to 5.2. because the tolerance is plus or minus 4%. Apart from that, some other features of this 78XX series is, it can handle up to 1 ampere of load current. So this pass transistor is capable of driving 1 ampere of current. Beyond that, it cannot drive and the complete IC would be shut down. And one more important part of this is thermal shutdown part, which I already told. Here the voltage or the threshold voltage is 175 degrees centigrade. Beyond this voltage, this thermal shutdown will turn off this pass transistor and no voltage you will get at the output of this IC. Because of the presence of these features, that is thermal shutdown and current limiting part, these devices, that is 78XX series ICs, are almost indestructible. Means there won't be a permanent damage for these ICs because of the presence of this block, which is thermal shutdown and current limiting. This is the brief explanation about this 78XX series devices. Now we shall see a specific device, which is 7805. Some of the features related to 7805. So this is a 7805 fixed IC regulator, which is one of the devices in 78XX series family. And here we are going to study some of the features. As I told, this 78XX series is a 3-terminal voltage regulator IC. So 7805 IC is shown here. It is having the input terminal where you apply the input voltage. And there is output terminal, which is pin number 2, where you get the constant output voltage. Apart from these two terminals, 1 and 2, we have third terminal, which is the common terminal. To this, we usually connect the ground. These are the connections with respect to LM7805 or simply 7805. And here, some other features of this 7805 IC are, the first one is output voltage is 5 volt. As the name indicates, 05, it will give a output voltage of 5 volt. Along with that, the maximum load current can be 1 ampere. Right? So up to 1 ampere, it can drive the current. Beyond 1 ampere, the IC would be shutting off. Then load regulation. What is load regulation? You already know. Load regulation is a variation in the output load. So it can have a load regulation of up to 10 millivolt. So it can make or it can cover up to 10 millivolt variation in the output voltage, provided the load current is between 5 milliampere and 1.5 ampere. So if the load current is between this range, 5 milliampere and 1.5 ampere, so this can manage up to 10 millivolt plus or minus variation in the output load. That is what is load regulation. With respect to line regulation, what is line regulation? Line regulation is variation in the input voltage. So this can cover up to 3 volt plus or minus 3 millivolt variation in the input voltage. input voltage can be increased by 3 millivolt or decreased by 3 millivolt, output would not be affected. So it can cover up to 3 millivolt, and it will perform this line regulation under condition that the input voltage is between 7 to 25 volt. If this Vin, applied Vin, is 7 volt to 25 volt, then only it can successfully perform the line regulation. Beyond this range, that is, if voltage is input voltage is 5 volt or about 27 or 26 volt, this would not perform any line regulation. Apart from that, we have one more feature, that is ripple rejection. So ripple rejection means the capacity of this IC to reject the ripple at the input, right? Usually this type of voltage regulator will be applied after the capacitor filter. We know that the rectifier performs AC to DC conversion. The output of rectifier has more amount of ripples. Therefore, we connect a capacitor filter. The capacitor filter will reduce the ripples to a maximum extent. Still, we have some amount of ripple present in the output of capacitor filter. Therefore, we connect an voltage regulator like this 7805 IC to reject or to remove ripple from the output to a higher extent, right? So it is having a ripple rejection of around 80 dB. dB stands for decibel. Then output resistance. The output resistance of this IC is around 0.01 ohm. Some other typical values are the values for the bypass capacitors. So here we can see during connection, we usually put one capacitor at the input terminal, which is called as C1, and one more capacitor at the output terminal, which is called as C2. The purpose of C1 is to prevent the oscillations which arise due to the variation at the input voltage. This input voltage, usually it would be the output of capacitor filter, and there would be some kind of oscillations in the input voltage. Therefore, to avoid the oscillations, we have this capacitor C1. So the voltage across this capacitor would act as actual input voltage for this 7805. And we know the property of capacitor, that it will slowly charge. Once it charges to maximum extent, it would hold that charge, and it will not allow any kind of variations in that charge to a fixed amount of time, right? So we are going to take the help of that property of this capacitor, which tells that the capacitor will work like a voltage source. So we are taking the benefit of that feature of this capacitor, and this is connected at the input as one of the bypass capacitor. Similarly, at the output, to get a proper frequency response, we connect one more capacitor. This will also help into generating a constant output voltage, Vout, at the output terminal. So the typical values of these two would be 0.1 to 1 microfarad. So it can be between range of 0.1 to 1 microfarad. So the data sheet of this 78XX series would suggest around 0.22 microfarad for this input capacitor. Means this is one of the specific value which is given by the manufacturer. The specific value for this C1 to be 0.22 microfarad, and the value for C2 to be 0.1 microfarad for this output capacitor. And it is having a dropout voltage of 2 to 3 volt. So dropout voltage means if you are having 7805 IC, 7805 IC is expected to produce constant output voltage which is equal to 5 volt. That is, Vout should be 5 volt. To get a Vout of 5 volt, you should apply Vin, which is greater than 2 to 3 volt from the input voltage. That is, you have to apply Vin of 7 volt or 8 volt. That is what is required. Suppose you apply Vin which is also equal to 5 volt, then this IEC would not perform any kind of voltage regulation. That is what is a dropout voltage. Usually this dropout voltage would be 2 to 3 volt, and 2 to 3 volt means the input should be greater than 2 to 3 volt from the expected output voltage. So this completes all the theoretical topics which are there in this module 1. So we now we shall have some of the numerical examples. We shall see some of the numerical examples on as a approximate diode approximations, that is equivalent circuit of diode. This topic. Equivalent circuit of diode is nothing but a model which replicates the behavior of diode. The first model is a piecewise linear model. Here this diode, the response of this diode is modeled by a voltage source, a DC voltage source or a battery whose value is VT. This is 0.7 for silicon, 0.3 for germanium. Along with that, we have a dynamic resistance RD, which is slope of this forward characteristic RD, change in VD by change in ID. And we have ideal diode. Ideal diode means it is an ideal switch. Whenever you increase voltage in forward direction, the current will immediately flow. Therefore, this is just like a short circuit for forward bias condition. And this would be a open circuit for reverse bias condition. The second model is the approximate model. And usually this model is used for most of the circuit analysis. Here, this consists of only the battery, which is 0.7 for silicon, 0.3 for germanium. And this is ideal diode. Here the value of RD would be zero. Ideal diode means it is an ideal switch where this will conduct as soon as you apply a voltage which is beyond VT. Here. So we shall use these two models, and in specific we use this approximate model to an extensive time to perform analysis of the circuits. This first problem already I have discussed in previous class. I will just have a quick recap of this. So the first circuit here, this is the circuit A. What we have to do is we have to find the value of I. This is your silicon diode where the anode or positive terminal of diode is connected to negative terminal of supply. The cathode, that is negative terminal of this diode, is connected through this resistance to the positive terminal of this battery. Therefore, this diode is reverse biased. Hence, no current would flow in circuit number 1. Therefore, I is 0 for circuit A. For circuit B, here the connection is like this. The negative terminal of diode is connected to negative terminal of battery. Positive terminal of battery is connected to positive terminal of the diode. Therefore, this would be forward biased and a finite amount of current will flow through this. And this circuit has two branches. One is the first branch where we have only a 10 ohm resistor. In the second branch, we have a diode along with a resistance of 20 ohm. So here the applied voltage 20 volt, this would be common for branch 1 and branch 2. For both branches, the voltage would be 20. Therefore, taking this fact into consideration, we shall easily calculate the value of I. As we know, the voltage across this complete branch is 20. Therefore, I would be equal to 20 minus 0.7. So the voltage across this complete branch is 20. 20 minus 0.7. 0.7 means you have to replace this diode with the approximate model. Approximate model consists of this voltage source, which would be 0.7 for silicon and an ideal diode. So if you replace this silicon diode with approximate model, you will have a small voltage source here. Therefore, you have to subtract the applied voltage 20 with the voltage source value 0.7 divided by the resistance. Resistance is 20. Therefore, after simplification, you get 19.3 in the numerator divided by 20. So this comes to be 0.965 ampere. The current through this is 0.96 ampere. And the value of this resistance 10 ohm would not affect the current which is 0.965 which is flowing through this. Therefore, the significance of this branch or this branch where a resistance is connected is of almost less significance. We don't have any significance of this. Without considering this branch itself, we can directly calculate the current. Then the last circuit, which is circuit C, here we have two diodes which are connected in opposite direction. This is one branch of the circuit. One more branch, we have a resistance. As these two diodes are connected in opposite direction, You can see the polarities. The negative terminal of battery is connected to positive terminal of this diode. Therefore, obviously this would be reverse biased. If this is reverse biased, it means that the complete circuit and the complete branch is open. Here there is no connection, there is no closed path. Therefore, this branch will be completely open and is of no significance. And the value of I would not be affected by this complete branch. Therefore, directly we can calculate I ignoring this branch. Hence, the equivalent circuit for this would be this one, which is shown in 2.7D. Here you can see a 10 volt is directly applied to 10 ohm resistance. Therefore, here one more thing is the current is shown in this direction, but actually conventional current will flow from positive terminal of battery through this resistance and it will reach the negative terminal of battery. Therefore, the conventional current direction is opposite to that of the direction shown of the intended current. We have to calculate this current I, which is in reverse direction of that of conventional current. Therefore, there will be a negative sign in our calculation. So here 10 volt, we are using the Ohm's law, 10 volt divided by 10 ohm, minus 10 volt divided by 10 ohm, that will be minus 1 ampere. This is a new problem. This has not been covered in the last classes. Here what we have to find out is we have to determine ID and V naught for this circuit using approximate diode model. So the first step in circuit analysis of these kind of problems is we have to replace the diode with the model given, right? So here they have given approximate model. So first replace this silicon diode with approximate model. Approximate model consists of a battery and an ideal diode. Ideal diode is just like a short circuit. Therefore, I have not shown the ideal diode here, right? That is the first step. Then afterwards, you have to see the direction of ID, which is given. So ID is given in this direction, right? Then you have to see what are the parameters that you have to calculate. You have to calculate ID value and V naught. So from this equivalent circuit, what you can calculate easily is the value of ID, right? The value of ID. At this point, we have applied one more voltage source, which is DC voltage source of 8 volt. So this terminal is at 8. And again, we have a resistance. The current will flow through this resistance and also it will flow through resistance 4.7. So two resistances are there. Then afterwards, we have a voltage source of 0.7. Therefore, if you apply a KVL to this current Kirchhoff's voltage law, which you are familiar in the previous semester itself in basic electrical subject. So Kirchhoff's voltage law states that the summation of EMFs is equal to the summation of voltage drops or summation of IR drops. Summation of EMFs is equal to summation of IR drops in a closed path. So in case of EMFs, if you try to find out EMF, if you start from here, you have 8 volt minus one more is 0.7. So that is LHS of your KVL. To the RHS of KVL, you have two resistances. As current ID is common for both resistances, it would be addition of these two resistances into ID, right? By making some by taking some simplifications, we can put the product of this ID, that is R into ID, like this. You can take the R and cross multiply here. This is the resultant of the EMFs, 8 minus 0.7. So you will get around 7.3 divided by the denominator is 5.9. So this is in terms of kilo. Therefore, if you divide 7.3 by 5.9, you will get 1.237 amperes. As there is kilo here, 10 raised to 3, if it goes to numerator, it becomes 10 raised to minus 3. Therefore, put a milli here. Afterwards, if you can easily calculate V naught. So V naught would be I into R. So R is 4.7. V naught would be voltage across this. Therefore, R would be 4.7 multiplied by. And one more thing is here this V naught, this comprises of one more component, that is 0.7. Therefore, what you have to do is you have to add 0.7 to the value of V0. Therefore, it would be 4.7 into this current I into R, which is voltage drop across this resistance, 4.7 into 1.237 plus this voltage source, which is 0.7. So it comes around 6.51 volt. Next problem. This is very important.
Sir, how we get that 0.7 value?
Which one? This one, 0.7.
Yes,
0.7 is the voltage of this voltage of this voltage source, that is this battery. This battery is the equivalent model of this silicon diode, because in approximate model, you see the approximate model here. In approximate model, we have the battery which represents the threshold voltage or knee voltage. For silicon, it is 0.7. After that, we have a ideal diode. Ideal diode is a short circuit for forward bias condition. Therefore, I have not shown this in this circuit. Battery. The value of that battery is itself is 0.7 for silicon. Is it clear?
Okay, sir. Yes, sir.
And this V0 would be sum of this voltage drop and this battery. Therefore, I have written like this. 0.7 into current value, 4.7 into current value, which is the voltage drop across this resistance. Along with that, this one, right? This is the total voltage of V0. Next problem, this is very important problem. The first circuit, you see only the first circuit. For the diode circuits of this figure, determine V0 and ID. So this is V0 and this is ID. Now, if you observe this first circuit, instead of a voltage source, we have a current source, which is a 10 milliampere. But the problem is, we are not familiar to perform analysis of a circuit which has a current source instead of a voltage source. Therefore, what we have to do is, we have to first convert this current source, which is 10 milliampere, into a voltage source. So how to do that conversion is, we have to take the help of this current source, along with that, this resistance. The value of this resistance, which is connected parallel to this current source 10 milliampere, is 2.5 kilo ohm. The value of resistance is 2.5 kilo ohm. We have to take the help of these two components to perform a conversion of this current source to a voltage source. So you initially assume that we have only these two components connected in a circuit. That is, we have 10 milliampere. Along with the 10 milliampere, we have this 2.5 kilo ohm. The remaining part is not there. Then how would you calculate the voltage across this 2.5 kilo ohm? You would assume that a current of 10 milliampere flows through this, and you try to calculate the voltage drop, that is I into R. So you multiply 10 milliampere with 2.5 kilo ohm to get the voltage across this resistance. So that would be the voltage of the new voltage source. And to that new voltage source, we have to connect this resistance 2.5 in series. That is indicated here, right? So 10 milliampere into 2.5 kilo. Milli and kilo will cancel. So what you would get is 2.5 into 10. 2.5 into 10 is 25. So we have a converted voltage source, which is 25. Along with this, you should add the resistance in series, right? 2.5 kilo ohm, right? So this is a conversion of voltage source, conversion of current source to voltage source. Initially in our problem, we have current source. We have converted this current source to a voltage source, and the resistance we have retained, but the resistance in this conversion, it is connected in series rather than parallel in the original circuit, right? So this is the procedure of conversion of current source to voltage source, which is very important aspect in this problem. Apart from that, as usual, we have to convert this silicon diode with its model. We have to replace this silicon diode with its approximate model, and according to approximate model, in place of diode, we have to replace that with source. that is this battery of 0.7 for silicon, right? Now the remaining part of this problem is very simple. Now we know how to calculate ID. So calculate ID, again we have to apply KVL, or in simple terms, what we have to do is we have to take out the resultant of EMFs or the sum of EMFs and equate that to the sum of IR product. Therefore, here you will get on the LHS side, you would have ID as common, ID into 2.5 plus 1.25. That would be the IR products. And on the RHS side, the first EMF is 25 minus 0.7, right? So if you cross multiply, you will get ID as 25 minus 0.7 divided by 2.5 plus 1.25, which is around 6.48 milli. You have to perform simplification of this. You would get this much. 2.5 and 1.25, these two are kilo ohm. It means that there is a 10 raised to 3 in the denominator. If it comes to numerator, it becomes 10 raised to minus 3, which is nothing but milli. After getting that, what we have to do is we have to find out V naught. So V naught would be simply the voltage drop across this 1.25 kilo ohm, right? The current which is flowing through this is ID. Therefore, multiply ID value, which is 6.48, with 1.25 kilo ohm. 1.25 kilo ohm into 6.48 milli. Milli and kilo will cancel. You will get 8.1 volt. The value of this V naught would be 8.1 volt. Now, second part of this problem, which is this circuit. Here, you have a circuit where you have a 20 volt DC supply, which is connected to a resistance of 6.5 kilo ohm. Afterwards, you have a diode, a silicon diode, and the current flows in this direction. And here we have one more source, which is minus 5 volt. Minus 5 volt means at this end of the diode, we have a battery whose negative terminal is connected to the cathode of the diode. So here what would happen is we have to calculate ID. So ID will flow in this direction. As usual, you have to calculate this ID by using KVL. So to use KVL, what is KVL? Sum of EMFs equals sum of IR product. Here we have only one IR product, current ID into 6.5 kilo. That is one IR product. Equate that to the EMFs. So here we have three EMFs. One is this 20, right? Then you have one more EMF, which is 0.7, which is the equivalent circuit of this diode. So 20 minus 0.7 plus we have this 5 volt, right? So it is minus 5, means negative terminal comes first. Therefore, according to our KVL, as we are moving in this direction, we are getting negative terminal of battery first. We have to take this as plus 5. Therefore, your ID would be like this. ID would be 20 minus 0.7 plus 5. Why I have taken plus 5 for this source? Because negative terminal comes first. If we start analyzing this loop from this 20 volt, here also we find a negative terminal first. Then we find positive terminal. Positive terminal is connected to this end of resistance. Therefore, we have to take positive sign for the EMFs where we encounter the negative terminal of that EMF first. Here, in case of this diode, what would happen is we encounter the positive terminal of the battery first. So wherever we encounter positive terminal while traversing the loop, we should take it as negative sign in the KVL. So if following this principle, 20 minus 0.7 plus 5 in the numerator, at the denominator you have 6.5. 6.5 is nothing but this one, 6.5 kilo. So if you take kilo in the numerator, it becomes 10 raised to minus 3. So after simplification of this, you will get 3.783 milliampere. So that is the value of ID. After calculating ID, we have to calculate this V naught. So V naught is after this resistance. So you will get this V naught after subtracting the voltage drop across this 6.5 kilo ohm resistance with 20 volt supply, right? So 20 volt minus the voltage drop across resistance. How to calculate voltage drop? Use the current ID, 3.783 milli into 6.5 kilo. Milli and kilo will cancel. Therefore, the resultant is this much. if you perform simplification, you will get minus 4.3. So minus 4.3 would be the V naught value at this point. Or else you can take one more method. You can use one more method. Directly you can subtract minus 5 and 0.7. This is also one more way of getting V naught, because this end is connected to negative terminal of battery. The cathode is connected to negative terminal of battery, and anode is nothing but V naught. And we have one more voltage source, which is 0.7. We can directly calculate this as 4.3. The first method is a more suitable one. Then next problem, for this network we have to determine V naught 1 and V naught 2. So what is this network? We have a 12 volt DC source, then we have silicon diode. Output of this silicon diode means this node is named as V01 or V01. From this node we have a resistance which is 4.5 kilo which is connected in this way, and the other end of this resistance is connected with a germanium diode. And this terminal, that is positive terminal of this germanium diode, is V02, right? So here we have only this germanium diode. Suppose this germanium diode is forward biased, right? If you try to find out V02, this V02 will be exactly equal to the VT or knee voltage of this germanium diode, which is 0.3. Because in this, if you replace this germanium diode with equivalent circuit, you have only a battery whose positive terminal would be this V02, and the value of that battery would be 0.3, which is equal to VT of this germanium diode. Therefore directly we can find out V02, which is 0.3, right? So once we find out this V02, the remaining part of the problem is to find out only V01. So assume that this diode is forward biased. You will get V01 by subtracting the voltage drop across this silicon diode. The voltage drop across this silicon diode is nothing but a battery of voltage source 0.7. So 12 volt minus this 0.7 will give you the value of V01. 12 volt minus 0.7, you will get 11.3. This is the value of V01. This 4.5 kilo ohm does not have any significance in finding out V01 and V02. For this problem. Okay, I hope this is sufficient for today's class. In the next class we shall solve a few more problems, and also I am going to address any doubts or queries that you people have. You may post your queries or doubts to me directly, so that I will address all those doubts or queries in the coming class, that is on Tuesday.